and 10-6 feet high.
I the Agbali family, I want to welcome you to this celebration of the life of Francis Agbali. My name is Bill Ellis. I serve as the discipleship pastor of Emmanuel Baptist Church here in Lexington, Kentucky, where Francis was a watch care member and where he attended with his family. I want to thank Lindsay and the staff here at Clark Legacy Center that provided so much support during a difficult time, and appreciate their creativity in helping families through times of grief. So whether you're here in the room or you're watching online here or around the world, we welcome you today. I want especially to welcome those that are watching from Nigeria today. You honored us with the presence of your native son, and for that, we're all better. Francis Akumabi Agbali was born in Oyinba, Kogi State, Nigeria, to Emmanuel and Elizabeth on May 12, 1971. He passed away this past Friday, May 15, 2020, at the age of 49. Or as he posted on Facebook on his birthday just 10 years ago, 49 years, 588 months, 2,556 weeks and 6 days, 17,898 days, 429,552 hours, 25,773,120 minutes, 1,546,387,200 seconds. Lord, Francis wrote, I am grateful to live to see the seventh circle of sevens, ushering in the year of Jubilee. He says, I give you the glory. And that, in a nutshell, sums up his life, giving God the glory. Francis was a lecturer at the Federal University in Katsina, Northwest Nigeria, and a graduate student at the University of Kentucky with the goal of returning home to Nigeria to make a positive impact on his local agricultural community, especially in the area of post-harvest losses, which causes food to go to waste. He was passionate about finding ways to cut these losses and also improve other areas of agricultural practices for the Nigerian farm. He wants to be praying for his family as they grieve the loss of this special man, his wife of 19 years, Christina, their three sons, Gene Praise, Michelle, and Joshua, his brother, Reverend Father Anthony Agbali, his brother, Raphael, and his wife, Joy, his sister, Dr. Ajura Morris, and her husband, Kenny, numerous cousins, nieces, nephews, aunts, uncles, beloved family, and friends. Francis was preceded in death and is now reunited with his beloved sister, Augustina, and his dad.
My name is Ray Green, and I serve as on staff with Bill, and I serve as the lead pastor at Emmanuel. And my deepest condolences to you and your boys, who I'm praying for, not just today, but for many, many, many days to come. And we have so many things we're going through. So I wanted to read just a few scriptures with you guys this evening. First is found in Psalm 42. It says this, as the deer pants for the water brooks, so my soul pants for you. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God? My tears have been my food day and night. While they say to me all day, where is your God? These things I remember, and I pour out my soul within me. For I used to go along with the throng and lead them in the procession to the house of God. with the voice of joy and thanksgiving, the multitude keeping festival. Why are you in despair, O my soul? Why have you become disturbed within me? Hope in God, for I shall again praise him for the help of his presence. O my God, my soul is in despair within me, therefore I remember you from the land of the Jordan and the peaks of Bramon, the Mount Mazar. Deep calls to deep at the sound of your waterfalls. All your breakers, your waves, they roll over me. The Lord will command his loving kindness in the daytime, and his song will be with me in the night, a prayer to the God of my life. I will say to God, my rock, why have you forgotten me? Why do I go mourning because of the oppression of the enemy? As I shattering of my bones, my adversaries revile me, while they say to me all day long, where is your God? Why are you in despair, O my soul? Why have you become disturbed within me? Hope in God, for I shall yet praise him, the help of my countenance and my God. Many tears. Many tears. But there will be a day. There will be more than tears. He is Revelation, the very end of Scripture, promises this. And he will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no longer any death. There will no longer be any mourning or crying or pain. The first things have passed. He says, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. And I will give to the one who thirsts from the spring of the water of life without cause. Heavenly Father, we don't understand. We cannot comprehend. And when life in these moments come crashing over us like waves, when all of these different thoughts and emotions just flood our hearts and our heads, the only thing we have is your promises and your presence. In some moments like this, God, we cling to you. We pray for trust. We pray for strength. And in moments when we ask questions like, well, why? Why now? I pray that our trust in you would overshadow those questions. I pray, God, that you would bring strength to the family. I pray you bring strength Christina and the boys, that you bring strength to the entire family, the siblings. And God, I pray that they would keep their sight set upon one day when there will be no more tears. And I pray that you'll keep all of our eyes fixed on Jesus, who is the author, he's the perfecter of our faith. In your name we pray. Amen.
Sorry for arriving late. I had to go the other day from here up to Indianapolis to select a plot for Francis, because that's where the family decided that he will be interred. I'm coming to Louisville. That was a real traffic hold of first, I want to thank all of you who are present here.
Francis.
Family. His wife and three children. And the rest of our extended family. 26 years ago, almost November 18th, our father died. He died in the hospital in Enugu, Nigeria. When the news reached me, because Dad had always prepared us somehow, even from the age of 7, telling us some of his wishes as to what would happen if and when he dies. I knew them very perfectly. But when Dad died, I had to call Francis and say, just to cross-check with him whether what I heard was right and whether my thinking was okay. Then, over 7 years ago, we lost our sister, our younger sister, Augustina. I visited Nigeria in November 2012 when she was sick to be with her. Before we arrived, Francis was already there, commuting and leaving his job at the Federal Polytechnic, where he was lecturing there to be frequently with her sister. It did not come to cost. And when I heard the news my sister was sick and my mom was really troubling me that she wanted to go back, to return from the United States to Nigeria to see our girl, Francis was the one who picked us from the airport. I returned back to the United States end of November. January, our sister was still not dying. I was preparing for work on that fateful day when I got a call from Nigeria. It was Francis. He said, Augustina has checked out. And it's like, checked out? What do you mean? He said, Augustina is dead. Francis was doing all of those and the head of the family as it wants to claim to be, because every time there's been some tussle or some misconception, Francis wants to say that he is the head of the family, not me. And that is because on the day I was ordained, my late bishop then said that since I was becoming a priest and having a higher responsibility in God's house, Francis should take care of the Agbali family. And so he said that he was also ordained to be the head of the Agbali family. I told him the bishop might have said that, but I never considered that. But that is very true of Francis here, because his name, his middle name, is Akumari. Aku in Igala means gate. And the person Magi, somebody who follows or who opened a lock, which is the name, actually a title name of one of the Igala kings, the Akau of Igala. What happened was, there was the battle for succession. Their father had died, there were two. And the oldest one was out where they were doing the ceremonies of succession. And this guy, who eventually became Akumabi, went behind and opened the gate at the backyard and sat on the throne. And the tradition is, he who sat on that throne, regardless of the rites or rituals or succession, is the rightful king. So he became, he inherited that before his older brother, who actually was due to be the king. Francis as I was writing down today. I think that's what Francis precisely has done. That I can be his elder brother here, senior in age to him. But he has gone to claim his seniority in the heavenly place. Thank God for Francis' life. Sometimes we quarrel, sometimes we fight. And that's typical in families. Sometimes we don't even talk because we have hard feelings. And it's not very long ago that I had that with Francis. But one day I think he was traveling to Indianapolis where I live. And he called, I think, and also followed up with a message and said, you know, brother, I said, yeah. He said, oh, I picked this call today. I said, yeah, I picked a call. If you call me, if you don't call, I won't call you because of your bad behavior. He said, well, that's what he's talking about. That he wants us to be family. It's not about money, it's not about material things, but just to be family. And Francis, through this COVID period, has been calling and checking on me. And even I dropped out in my house, I think once or twice, just to check on me. On one occasion, he left a note on the door. And I was hungry as hell, precisely because with the COVID, why is he going traveling all over the place? But I'm sure he had something doing. And when Francis has a duty, he never hesitates. So, well, then after that, a few days after, I had a conversation with him. And that probably was my last conversation with Francis. And we reminisced about our childhood growing up. Francis is younger than me by 1 year, 5 months. So my mom got pretty pregnant after I was born. But I had to play with him. He was my play buddy in those days. And we used to fight also. And I would beat him real well. But then Francis fell sick with a polio-like sickness. And my play buddy, my fighting companion and troublemaker, was not able to really do the things we do together. And I remember just sitting always by his bedside and just pitying him. Then all of a sudden he recovered. And from that time on, even though I think I can beat him, I allow him to be the one to beat me every time he fought. So this is my brother here, whom I got a call last Friday. And precisely at 6:30 p.m. Eastern. I have not called him on his birthday, he made it work. And for some reason I had him in mind. But I work as a chaplain in a busy hospital. And we do have COVID patients. And I went in. And also I think we had a meeting that day, so we ran over. So I had to complete some of my paperwork and stuff that I do. And so, I stayed a little longer in the office, and I drove home and I said, what? I'll call him another time, maybe weekend. It never happened. Wednesday, I went back to work. It was kind of chaotic. I'm tired, I slept. Thursday, when I was leaving for work, I forgot myself. And on Thursday, when I came back from work, I looked for my phone. freeway. I couldn't find one. And I did not have another phone to call. And surprisingly, nobody called me at that point. Friday, I found my phone. And someone called me from Nigeria, a colleague of mine. And we finished speaking. And I was kind of thirsty. So I went downstairs to get a bottle of water. And I noticed my front door was open, was wide open. And I shut it. I think the wind blew it open. That was what I thought at the time. But today, I think I will think a little differently. Probably it was Francis. Because this is how Francis would bust into my door. Just open and sometimes leave it open. I said, no, please shut the door behind you because they are rodent. And slaters. And Francis never believed that the United States were rodents, rats, and stuff, or snakes. So, until my heart got infested at some point, and it took me almost 3 months to get rid of this stuff because I just don't like rodents. But Francis never thought anything. So, it was then I got this call from Francis' friend. The wife, Christina, has called after making attempts to reach us, as you told me later. And it was John, whom I'd known many years ago, I think 1987. This Professor John, who lives in Atlanta. That made that call. And after that call, because am I dreaming? Francis. Because whenever I see Francis, even if you are quarreling, because one thing I tell you two things. First, when he's coming to my house, I've asked him, call my head so that I may be out. Francis never offers me that because he was bouncy. When I talk, he say I'm trying to be too American. So then the second one, I'm using my pen. The second one is Francis never says I'm sorry when he wrongs you. He has his way of walking himself back into it. And sometimes I'm a little harder and I want that sorry. So, but when he comes around, he will give you this hug and then he will hit me at the back as a big brother. Everything is settled. Now Francis is gone. I was really angry on Friday. I was angry with God. I was also angry, even in some sense, with Francis. I was angry with everybody, even with Christina, his wife, for not being the one who called me. Because I wanted to know what happened. But as I thought about it, too, I didn't know she was there. But she's carrying a lot of God. Years with you. And I don't think she's regained herself, or she will anytime soon. So we have to pray, Francis is gone. That we know. But for Christina and his family, and their family, we have to pray for them. Perhaps God, why in 7 years will you take? Our father died at age 56. In January, I happened to turn 50. And my counter is, will I pass 56? Another failure. And also, we have had incidents of death in the month of November. also that when November is coming, sometimes there's this recognition, but it's not November, but it does because so those type of things have occurred in the family. My sister died at age 36. Francis at 49. I don't understand, but I know God knows and understand better. Because the scripture tells us it's not in the number of years, but in our world to be in a relationship with God and with each other and the universe. So as I round up, I want to say my brother lived the life only Francis could live, the way Francis decides to live. He was a good man in many respects, even when we disagree on some issues, because he had a way of relating with people in his own ways. And that I can attest when I came here the other day, how within a short time Francis has made out of God. I brought Francis here, I think 2015, right? When he first arrived. He first arrived in the United States in Indianapolis. I did not know Francis was coming in until about 2 days before, and he had sent me an email, and I had not read my email. So he called to tell me he was arriving. I said, "Danny, you're arriving when?" He says, "Arriving now." So then I said, "Okay, have a great time. And pick you." My mom was with us at the time, and she and I went to the airport. But Francis, my mom had just come to my house, and she woke up one morning, even though I told her, "Don't worry about breakfast for me. Just relax, you can control yourself." But she went down the stairs, and I think she had a fall. So when I came up, I saw her sleeping. I said, "Mom, are you okay? Why are you up?" So she came out to make breakfast, but she had a fall. I said, "Okay, let's go to the hospital." She said, "No, it's okay." Which I should have known better. I should have made her to go to the hospital. So this happened, and then 2 days later, Francis had arrived. And I was trying to fix up something for Francis to eat. And so in discussing with my mom, Francis was there real quickly that my mom was having asphyxia. She was slurring in her speech. He was at fault because my mom would just laugh when you say something, but his friend took up for. So we decided early in the morning we're going to rush out to the emergency. So Francis kept awake all night. So he was such an observant person who missed all of that. So we know he's going to be with God. And because he's with God, we are sad or we are happy. We no longer have to walk and get the body of the old car on his chest. But my sadness, my deep sadness, is his children growing up without a father that gave him love today. And the quarrel I fight with Francis about anything, but I know he dearly loves his family. He never goes away. There was a time he was going through some stress here, and I told him, "Well, buckle up and try to finish so that you can either bring them or you go back to Nigeria to continue the work." And he told me he will sacrifice anything for them. That because I'm a priest and I'm not married, I don't understand what he was going through. Because one day he said, he placed his chair in front of his apartment and he wept so dearly because of that separation. We know that they are separated once again, but this time we know Francis is still here with us. you, his wife, and children especially. More than you can ever imagine. I pray that you continue to live up in your own way, the values he has given to you. That you will excel even better than your father. And that the Lord will lead you. The Lord will encourage you.
Amen.
And provide you with safety and all he has in purpose for you. And as a family, we have gone through this many times than we can ever imagine now. My prayer is that God will help to give us in our family some longevity so that we can be with the children that God has given to us here, especially Francis and those of all our other family members. So once again, I want to thank each one of you that came here today. I want to thank the African students, the Nigerian students, this funeral home, the African community here in Lexington, Kentucky, and the many people who are stood by us, especially with Francis and his family at this time. I also want to thank members of the Igala community here in the United States who have also stepped up and taken us as their family in this situation. Francis, I don't think, was a registered member, but they told me that being of the Igala ethnic group, that is one of their own. He doesn't have to be registered. I appreciate that that kindness extended to him and to us, and to his family especially. My colleagues who are here in the United States that were here, or some of them, they had to leave in there. So I extend my appreciation also to them, the Catholic priest from Ida Diocese and Igala Land origin. And many people all over the world, especially from Nigeria, from our Igala ethnic group, from our own town of Ida, and many places. We pray that all of you who have reached out to us, that the good Lord will bless you and provide for you in all your needs. I cannot name everybody, but please, if you feel that I've not mentioned you, it's not personal, it's just memory lapse yet, but you are all appreciated for all your kindness. May God bless you, may God keep you, and may the Lord be your light and your shield.
The easiest funerals to preach are those of dedicated believers like Francis and Father, because their lives preach their funeral for them. Just a few weeks ago, Francis shared with the world on Facebook about his faith in Jesus by reading from the book of Romans, chapter 8. This book, written by the Apostle Paul, is his magnum opus, his greatest work, as it meticulously outlines for us the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Francis read verse 1 of Romans chapter 8, which says, "Therefore there is now no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus." He also read verse 9, which says, "You, however, are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God lives in you. He then asked his audience, are you in Christ? Are you living in the Spirit? What a special man he was. What a good person Francis was. Our world needs more people like Francis. As I come through the comments on the Clark Legacy webpage and the kind words on his Facebook, these are the words that I saw over and over. Thank you, friend, mentor, respect, servant, brother, godly man, good man, selfless man, amazing husband, amazing father, exemplary church member. Christy shared with me that their Nigerian pastor said that usually if you want to hear a lie, you go to a funeral. But what you hear about Francis, he said, is true. And it is. He was a good person. The world needs more like him. But his goodness didn't come from himself. It came from God. And as good as he was, he understood that we are all sinners. There's not one of us that is good. Our goodness comes as a gift of God, placing the righteousness of Jesus on us. Not because we are good, but because he is good. And while our sin, our badness, separates us from God, Francis chose to set aside the law of sin and death and take on the Spirit of life. Christ Jesus. And because of that, his life was never the same. And because of that, our lives and many others have been blessed because of his decision to follow Christ. People would meet Francis and instantly become fast friends. This happened over and over again. For instance, Francis lost his wallet. He and Christy searched for the wallet, but they didn't find the wallet. But someone did find the wallet, and they sent it to him in the mail. And they became friends. And upon hearing of Francis's death, this lady who found his wallet posted on Facebook, I'm at a loss for words. I just met Francis a few months ago when he lost his wallet. I opened it up to get his information and sent it to him right away. My sincere condolences to his wife, children, and family. This is the effect that Francis had. We need more people.
Thank you, Jesus.
Like Francis. He even endeared himself to his mother-in-law. She called him my first son. That doesn't happen very easily. But it did with Francis. Oh, Francis's smile was infectious. I'll just be honest with you. There are some people that I don't necessarily want to see when I'm at church on Sunday. I'm sorry, but I have to confess that little bit. However, I love seeing Francis. He was one of those people I couldn't wait to see. And whenever I saw him, do you know how I found him? With a smile. Christy shared with me that even when things were difficult, it didn't affect his mouth. Oh, I love that. I hope I never forget that, Christy. And I'll always remember Francis' smile. We need more people with smiles that serve as such an encouragement to others. We need more people like Francis. Francis' friend Joe shared with me that He would share proverbs and often mention this quote, which is from William Shakespeare in the play Julius Caesar. The quote is this: "A coward dies 1,000 times before his death, but the valiant tastes of death
but once."
It seems to me most strange that men should fear, seeing that death, a necessary end, will come when it will come. This is echoed in the same chapter of Romans, chapter 8, verses 37 and 38, which say this: "In all things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord." You see, the coward dies a bit each and every time they back down from what they think or feel or know they must do. And Francis followed the call of God on his life. He didn't fear death, as many may fear death today. He knew that death would come only once, and after that, the promise, the beginning of eternal life. I mentioned at the beginning of my remarks that he was a, what we call a watch care member of our church. This is a special designation we provide for people when they ask us, typically usually for students who don't want to move their membership from their home church while they're in school, but they still want to identify with a local body of believers. Francis and Christy are actually in the video that we've used to introduce our worship services online right now. Francis is smiling, he's talking with his friend John in the hall outside our worship center. The fact that Francis took this step of wanting to be under watch care of another church is a testimony to his love for the bride of Christ, for the church, both in his home in Nigeria and his adopted home in Lexington, Kentucky. And then there was his love of cars, working on things with his hands, fixing things and helping others with their automotive problems. Christy shared with me about the time they were going to Louisville, and he stopped to help someone. And this person kindly said to him that they had help on the way. And so Francis went on down the road, and after he was through with his task and was heading back home, later in the day, he's returning on that same road and notices that the lady was still in her car alongside the road, still waiting for someone to help her. And so what did he do? He turned around, he went back to her car, and after determining she was out of gas, he went and got some fuel and got her back on the road. That's the kind of guy he was. One of his friends from the University of Kentucky, Joe, shared with me that Francis would look for cars that he might fix up and resell. And he was bidding in an online auction when he unexpectedly found himself as the high bidder and the winner of this auction. Now, all he had to do was just go and pick up the car, right? He was uncertain of its location, and so he says to Joe, "Hey, Joe, where is Nebraska?" For those of you that don't know, it's over 700 miles from Lexington to Nebraska, and for Francis, it was a 20-plus hour bus ride to pick up his new car. One of his friends from our church, John, shared that helping others with their car needs was just part of who Francis was. It was his ministry, and he was happiest when he was giving of his talents and helping others. Of course, all these acts of kindness took away from Christy and later their family. Indeed, Francis was generous with his time, with his talents, serving others and meeting their needs. One of his friends shared with me that he was generous, perhaps even to a fault. Christy said she was talking to her Nigerian pastor about this, and his reply was to leave Francis alone. This Nigerian pastor said that's how God created him and his pastor was right. Oh, how our world needs more people like Francis, who think of others, how they might serve them, how they might meet their needs. While Francis' love of service and helping others was very practical, it was also very, very spiritual and grounded in his personal relationship with Jesus. Christy recalled how this went back to the very beginning of their relationship. After meeting in a Bible study on campus, she remembered how Francis would go out into the villages nearby and he would share with others his passion for Jesus. His sister Ajura shared that that during her pregnancy, doctors were concerned that her baby was too big and she wouldn't be able to have it on her own. And so she was waiting an induction on Monday. But she called her brother on Sunday afternoon. And in his calm demeanor, was he ever anything but calm, Christy? Was he ever? In his calm demeanor, he told his sister, "Stop crying. Place your hand on your stomach. Talk to your baby. What name have you chosen for your baby? Say his name. We will pray together." After the prayer, Ajura said she felt peace. She felt peace. And later that evening, long before the induction scheduled for the next day, she delivered their baby with no complications. James chapter 5, verse 16 says, "The prayers of a righteous man availeth much." When you are people who pray, like Francis. Christy was sharing with me that Francis was recently talking with the boys about their need to follow Jesus on their own and to be baptized, helping them understand that each one of us needs to determine for ourselves if we will take that step to follow God. We need more fathers like Francis who disciple their children and lead them to Christ. In his video on Facebook, Francis shared that there are more people dying around the world of fear than there are people dying around the world of this virus. Indeed, more people will die in fear, not knowing where they will spend eternity. They will die because of this virus. We need more people like Francis who smile and encourage others. We need more people like Francis who love the Lord, who are following him each and every day, who are committed to the church, to fellowship with others and growing in their faith, who are using their gifts to minister to others, who are loving and discipling their families. We need more people like Francis. My friend, perhaps that person is you today. You can be that person that we need in the world. Let's start right now, everybody in here, even though you all have masks on, let's start with a Francis smile. Would you smile underneath your mask for me? That Francis smile. See, we can do this. But more importantly than his smile, let's go back to the question that Francis asked in that Facebook video, which I shared at the beginning a few moments ago. His question was this: are you in Christ? Or are you in fear of what the future holds, dying 1,000 times over? Will you make that all-important decision that Francis made and choose the spirit of life, asking Jesus to come into your heart and follow him each day? You can do that today. You can do that right now. To start your own relationship with God, it begins with admitting that you aren't good on your own, that you accept God's provision of goodness, and then you let the righteousness of Jesus cover you and lead you in the power of his Holy Spirit. It has been good for us to gather, to remember the life of Francis Agbali today. I now look forward to seeing how his life continues to encourage you, to challenge you, and to see what God does through you and through your lives, given to the spirit of life that is found in a relationship with Jesus. Would you pray with me?
Yes.
Lord, we thank you for the opportunity that we've had to experience life with Francis Agbali. And Lord, we thank you for the way you've used him to influence, bless, and serve others. And Lord, while we feel his time was way too short, we are grateful for these 49 years. And Lord Jesus, we thank you for his testimony, devotion to you. I pray, Father, that each of us would come to understand our own need for Jesus as our Savior, that we will take that next step in our relationship with you right now, whatever it may be, and that we would live valiant lives of courage for you. These things we pray in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
authority throughout the United States and throughout the world, who was cheating the penny, a dollar, to ensure that we honor Francis. I'd like to say thank you to the University of Kentucky, to the faculty and staff. His nephews and nieces would like to sing I Do This Song of Farewell. This song is an Igala, and though they don't know all the words in Igala, it's an Alleluia song. And the song says, Alleluia,